Amen. Thank you. We'll use this, JR. Thank you so much. Thank you, Brittany, for that song, Pastor Chris, Miss Donna. Praise the Lord for that. What a great song, too, that we can have as we look last week, Victory in Jesus. In fact, there's a book that Brother Shetler was on his table last week that we are giving out to the teens that we're asking them to use. We're going to start on Wednesday night with these. We've ordered a bunch more of these, and this is what was talked about on Sunday night. It's called Victory. It's a seven-step strategy for resisting temptation, overcoming sin. So if you would like one of those books, just let me know, but we'll have them for the teens. So before I jump into the message, I just wanted to share a few words about what's going on tonight at the church, where we're headed as a church, and kind of why I'm excited about a lot of things here at the church. So first of all, tonight is our annual budget approval meeting, and that's going to be at 5:30, and that's going to be in the fellowship hall. I just want to say, in way of passing, since we have the conference here, we weren't able to really get together like we normally do on a Sunday night and discuss, but God has been good this past year and the past many years, and we finished each year with less debt, greater reserves, and in several months, we're going to pay off the mortgage, which is a great blessing. And God has been so good, and we've been very careful and prayerful and wise with the Lord's money, and we just are very thankful for what God is doing. This year, also, we finished the budget year $18,000 in the black, and God has allowed us to meet all of our needs. And in the last year alone, through Project Restoration, many of you have seen this, we've been able to do what you see back here, the baptistry, rock wall and lights, the foyer, the welcome center, things you don't see. We've put new gutters on the church, which are important, the fellowship hall. If you've noticed that, when you would walk into the fellowship hall, you would get drenched and dumped on because the rain coming off, we put a gutter system there. We replaced doors around the campus, upgraded the nursery, painted the kids' building, the outside of it, added new lighting outside, painted the porch on the fellowship hall in the youth building, installed sound panels. We built a new awning for the church vans, put up a new fence at the ball court, remodeled the church offices. That was almost a year ago. If you've been in there, you've seen that. We've completed a tech upgrade with internet, which will be done this week, which will provide internet to every building and the entire campus. So that'll be done this week. And it's all been done during the last couple of years, especially this last year, in this economy, while we pay our bills, pay off our debt, and while we meet our needs. And so God is, there's been just a lot of things. I know that's kind of rapid succession, because when you get the piece of paper at the Welcome Center, you see numbers. And what do these numbers mean? What is this? And really what you don't see in that is also what's represented in what's been going on. But God has been good. But there are two areas I do want to, before jumping into the message, I want to challenge you in. And there's two areas. It's tithing and missions. And these are, again, areas that I would say if one was lacking more than the other, we're going to cover that. I personally believe that God wants every Christian involved in the local church ministry of sharing the gospel, of supporting the church. It's a rarity that I will get up and we don't have the thermometer on the stage. We need this and we're striving for this goal. I just pray that God's people, that I know how my parents taught me, I know what I believe from God's word, and I know what we do as a family, that we give 10% of our income to the Lord, to the Lord's work. And if God allows us and moves on our heart, we give more to missions. We give above what we give to our church in regards to that. And God, I believe, blesses us when we just obey, when we say, God, I'm going to give you what I believe the Bible teaches. I believe the foundation, not the ceiling, the foundation is 10%. That's what it was commanded in the Old Testament. I don't necessarily, we won't have that debate, but that's where I begin in our family for us personally. Now, you have to come to grips with what God would have you to do, but I believe the foundation is there. That's not the ceiling. What does God want us to do? It's interesting, up at Penny Farms, just down the street, J.C. Penny, you read his life story, a Christian man, who by the time before he died was giving 90% of his income to the Lord and living off the 10. And this man, J.C. Penney, who built Penny Farms, was a great businessman, but he, first of all, was a believer. And you can read the stories of great men and women of the past, but ultimately, what God is doing at our church is a direct result of our obedience to Him and what we believe He says in His Word, how we live it out and apply it. So God has been good in that regard, and we have You know, we've had a few deaths in the church of men who, you know, they were giants in their own right, testimony-wise, but they believed in the local church. They gave. You know, even with people that might be moving or people that might go on to heaven, you know, the Lord's work has continued not only this year, but every year, all throughout time. But we get to partner with the Lord to say, how can we not just keep the lights on, but Lord, what can we do to work to see your kingdom, your work accomplished in this world? But I say secondly, not just in tithing, but in world missions. And this is an area where you do see it in the budget sheet, but you don't necessarily maybe see it reflected unless you take one of these every week. You know, our need, when you look here, for missions is about $3,900. I'm just going to make sure I look at that right. That is correct. Now, last year, we didn't meet budget on that. We have a missions budget or a missions fund that has kind of the overflow of money in it that if there's a need or a missionary says, hey, we need X, we did that. Brother Hess, who's in Ukraine, he came 3 years ago and we gave money. I think it was about 1,000. Someone in the church also gave another 1,000 to that to help build a building in Ukraine for their church. And if there's a need, we have the missions fund, but the missions giving is not some nebulous thing that we just kind of, like many denominations, just throw money at, and then there you go. We have 40 particular missionaries that we support around the globe. You met the Browers. They came in November in Tanzania and Kenya. There's other ones that are around the globe that we support and here at home. So when you give money to missions, now, there's a set amount for each missionary, and we make sure that they get that check every month to help support them. Some we support at $200, some at $150, some at $100. And, you know, on Tuesday nights, Miss Penny, so when we put the kids to bed and we pray, Miss Champlin is Tuesday or Thursday? It's Tuesday. It's Miss Champlin. She's in her 90s. And she's still serving the Lord in Suriname with her family after her husband died. And she corresponded, was our missionary for children in our children's church maybe 2.5 years ago. But she wrote letters to the kids. She sent things to the kids. Every dollar given to the church in missions, if you write missions on it, that money goes to missionaries, not to some organization that then filters it out and it goes to administrative costs. It's going to missionaries. And that's one area, although this year we finished a little higher, I believe it was about 43,000, Pastor Chris, maybe close to 44. We need closer to 48, 49. So we were a little short in that category. Now we have our missions fund, but that one area, you know, I want you to just pray about giving to that. Pray about what God would have you to do. Just even if it's a start, a baseline of, I'll give $10 a week or a month. I'll just start somewhere just to give to missions. And missions is, you know, for our family, and just give you that baseline, we give a certain amount each year, and then we pray about the Lord helping us to increase that mission giving each year just to see if we can stretch a little bit more, even with our tithe, with, you know, the 10% grows to whatever percent the Lord does in our life. And Claire and I were talking about this the other day as we were looking at our giving. And when I was a youth pastor in Lakeland and Taylor was about, well, she was pregnant with Taylor, and we had to cut out so many things in our life because of the ministry. There was a lot of things going on in the church, and it was a very difficult time. We had to make sacrifices, but the very first check that we always wrote, not because as Christians we belong to some cultish mentality where we worship a leader and we give to something regardless of the needs that we have, but we believe biblically the Bible says that we give to the Lord first. And that is the first thing that, as a family, that we do. And you need to know it's not something that's just preached, but that is something that is practiced. And I believe for every Christian, God could help us this year especially to not only meet, I would love to meet our missions budget, but to actually surpass that. There are missionaries that we have waiting in the wings that I have talked to for the last three or four years, that there are missions, there are countries where there is no gospel witness in certain areas. And I would love to do that, but we have to meet our needs there first. So give to the Lord through your tithes. What does God want you to do? And it's a step of faith, but it actually, for tithing, it's a step of obedience. God, what do you want me to do? Show me how to do this, Lord. And if, you know, I was blessed and fortunate, my wife as well, to have parents that taught us that in the home, and we learned at an early age and continue that. We check in with our kids away at college, that the church where they're attending, what they do, and that they're involved, but that they're also giving with what they make into missions. There's that. So tonight at 5:30, next door in the fellowship hall, we're going to have the budget, we're going to have the vote, and I ask you to come, and we're going to meet on the side of the fellowship hall. And then at 6 o'clock, we're going to have a camp supper. So at 6 o'clock, now listen, we got moms, grandmas, and teenagers making some food. There's ham, mashed potatoes, mashed taters, green beans, nanner pudding. I've heard of, like, it's a nana pudding overload possibly tonight with other desserts, sweet tea, coffee. And this is to help the young people go to camp. It won't be just one time, but we're just asking if you come tonight, just $5 a plate. And, you know, if you do that at the door, or if you just want to give something to the young people, you say, well, I can't be there to eat. Well, just come because it's the fellowship. And especially now, we need you to be here to support and help and love on the young people as they go to camp. Dr. Shetler spoke last week. That's the kind of preaching that they get. That's the kind of teaching they get at summer camp. So please be out tonight. And if you're a teenager, you're going to camp, or you haven't signed up yet and you want to go to camp, you need to be here tonight. Be here at 5:30. I'm meeting the fellowship hall. Last two areas I'll mention are our youth and kids. So, you know, I help lead game time in Awana. And what does that mean, Marty and Cheryl, for Cubbies, for Marty, for Maury's grandkids, and for your grandkids, Myra and Rusty? That means that you basically just have to pray to the Lord that they haven't had anything sweet that day, so that when they come, the Cubbies, which are, they're less than 4 years old, they're three, basically, just come out. You want to see something funny? Just come and watch us. But if you laugh, I will bring you in and draft you. But those kids have so much life and energy. I get to lead game time on Wednesday nights with all the kids. But the Cubbies first, the Sparkies, which are, you know, you got to basically kindergarten to about second grade, then the TNT, third grade up to sixth grade. And I'm going to begin leading youth on Wednesday nights from 7 to 8, which we did this past week with parents, and it was a wonderful time. But I'm going to have to step out of our game time for the kids. We've got some other people that are feeling that, but if you would like to come and just help, and by help, that's a broad term, you want to help. If you come and you're standing there, I'll put something in your hand, whether it be a rake, a rope, a child, something. If you want to help in any way, we need your help, and we'd love to have that. We've got a great group of adults, probably like 15 adults for Awana that come and serve. And they're wonderfully talented and they're great, but we make sure for every adult there's about four kids. And we have kids coming to church on Wednesday night that their parents don't go to church at all. And some of them don't come to church on Sunday. They haven't been to church in years, but they bring their kids to hear the word. We had a new family come on Wednesday night. The mom and dad came, and I'm looking around, and I don't believe I see them. We invited them to come, but their son came, and they said, well, just last week, we had a family member pass away, and our son, who went into Sparks, I think he's what, Claire, second, first grade, been asking questions about death and dying in heaven. And we have friends that come to Awana, and his friend at school said, you should come to Awana with me, and we have questions about that, so we want to bring him tonight. Do you think y'all can answer those questions for him tonight? Bought a vest for Awana, got a book, all of that stuff, filled out the things. We talked to them a little bit, found out their story, that they are very religious. They grew up in church, but they want to make sure their kids get taught. We have a lot of that on Wednesday night that you might not see translated on a Sunday morning, and the prayer is that we get Wednesday night youth and Wednesday night Awana translated into the fruit that remains for the parents and the kids knowing the Lord and growing in the Lord. But you can be a part of that and help. Mission money we send, and we pray that God will use what we send to them. You have a mission that's not across the ocean, but that is right across the campus. There's missions here you can support by Sunday school, bringing your children, your grandchildren, bringing yourself to come in to Sunday school Wednesday night, Sunday night. Just being a part of that. And for right now, I'm going to be leading that, so I just need a little bit of, I won't say help, in the regard that it's just going to be dumped on you. We don't believe in dumping things on others, just we believe in sharing the load and working together. And I love our church. I mean, I love the fact that God has us here, but I love working with your kids and your grandkids. I love working with you. You don't know true love unless you've been in a van with a bunch of retired men driving to Lake City to go to, what's the name of that place? Is it? It's not Brown's. What's Old Country Buffet. And George Woody has somewhere he wants to take you, and you end up almost in Georgia. So I love those guys. I love our widows. They're going to meet on Tuesday, and they're going to have a great time up at Keystone Inn at 11 o'clock. Every group, every family, every person, be it shut-in member, people watching at home that haven't come out, young people, children in the nursery, it's an absolute joy just to talk and sit and listen. Yeah, there are tears sometimes. Sometimes it's difficult, but man, I have fun. I thought maybe on Wednesday night I had offended Jesse's girlfriend, which I didn't know it was Jesse's girlfriend at the time, and I'm going to put Jesse on the spot. He's going to turn 13 shades of red. But basically, before she left, I had her believing that she was a homeless pirate's daughter that was picked up on the side of the road. But we had young people there on Wednesday night, and then we have them in Awana, and all of them, just the reason that they're here is because that they know that somebody loves them and they care. And that's it. And we do. And we're going to continue to do that. And what you see on the foyer center, the Welcome Center, are just numbers on a page, but they represent what God has allowed you to do. And the fact that by May, June, July, right in there, we could pay off our debt here at this church and still be able to get things done at the church and have ministry support missionaries. And actually, I'm so excited. There's so much. I do not like surprises. I want to know what's happening. I was the kid like Wanda that would want to go in there and look at the presents before, you know, what shake this, what is this? Okay, this could be. And there's so many wonderful things I know that God has planned for our church that we have been discussing, we have been planning. And rather than just throw it out there on you, I can't wait to see God unfold it. There's some really wonderful things. So just please pray, be involved. If you want to help on Wednesdays, if you want to help with youth or with kids, in the bulletin is my number. Text me. If you don't have that kind of phone, email me. If you don't have a computer, see me. Just let me know. And if you want to come out and be involved in Freedom Kids, Sunday morning church, puppets, teaching or leading, Sunday school, Awana, youth, helping us find directions to Lake City. Now that George is in heaven, he's probably laughing at us now when we get lost because I'm the one driving. But it's just so much fun to serve the Lord. And it's been such a joy this week as we have just seen God do some amazing things. So with all that being said, long commercial break. Now let's get into God's Word. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're going to look at one verse today. One verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're going to look at verse number 9. They say nothing can ever prepare you for life after graduation, marriage, parenting, a career, even ministry, or perhaps it's fill in the blank, life. Nothing can compare you or prepare you for these things. And what we discover after getting into these things, marriage, parenting, career, ministry, actually we discover more than we actually expected. And it takes a lifetime to really learn this. Well, we're going to talk about that today. This verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, deals with that reality. Man's wisdom is like the tip of the iceberg. And if honestly, we could really relate it. Man's wisdom is like the ice cube on the iceberg. And the wisdom that is found in God is actually beneath the surface. And Paul's going to relate that here. So we cannot discover the big E, eternal wisdom, that only comes through knowing God and His Word and through His Spirit. We can't know the biggie without by the little e's, by our eyes, our ears, our emotion, is He going to say the heart. We can't discover those things of God that are eternal just through a human process, how we feel about it, what we think about it, what we experience. So we know so little about these things, yet often we build our lives on the little e's, how we feel about it, what we see, what we hear. Everything that we do is based on some emotional response to some event in our lives or some person or something. But the biggie, the eternal truth, the eternal wisdom of God is really what lies beneath the surface. And this verse today deals with that reality. Look at verse number 9. It says, "But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him." Dear Lord, help us this morning as we just talk about this verse. Use it, Lord, to encourage our hearts. Thank You, Lord, for a blessing that You've been to my heart this week and last week, not only through Brother Shetler, but even after he's gone, the ministry of just serving Your people here and serving with them, their children, their grandchildren, the families, everybody, Lord. May You just speak to our heart through Your Word that we would not just be led by the little e's in our life, our eyes, our ears, our emotions, but Lord, by the biggie, the eternal truth that is found in Your Word. Lord, may we look to You and may You use us, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. So nothing can prepare you for life after graduation. People tell you about it, I can't wait to get out. Marriage, I can't wait to get married. Then you get married. Nothing can really prepare you. Parenting, boy, I can't wait to have kids, and then you do. And nothing can really prepare you for that. Or that career, boy, I just can't wait to make money, but then you realize you got to put up with some stuff once you get the money, because money doesn't grow on trees. Nothing can prepare you for that. And ultimately, when you come to the wisdom that is found in God, the eternal truth, nothing, humanly speaking, can prepare us for what God has in store. What God has prepared, Paul writes it here, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, it's not even entered into the heart or the emotion of man, the things that God has prepared for them that love Him. So the question then is, well, what has God prepared? What does God want to do with my life as a teenager, as a young adult, as a young family, as a young parent, as a single adult, as a divorcee, as someone that has lost their spouse, as someone who's retired, someone who's searching, what does God want to do with my life? What does God have, notice the verse, prepared for me? I love the Lord. What does God have prepared for me? Well, there's two things. I believe He has a future and He has a present. She sang about that. Victory in Jesus, streets of glory. We're going to go there one day. We read about it in our text, Revelation 21, verses 1 through 4. New heaven, new earth, tears are gone, sorrow's gone, sickness gone, pain gone. There's a future. So there's going to be separation from sin. We're going to be in the presence of God. There's going to be no more wheelchairs, no more doctors, no more cancer, no more appointments, no more cemeteries, none of that. We'll be in the presence of God. Someone said, heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. Hell is a prepared place for unprepared people. Heaven is prepared. There is something that God has for us, but is that what this verse is talking about? Two books, one called The Boy Who Came Back from Heaven, and another book called 23 Minutes in Hell. Both books are a farce. In fact, the author, Kevin, the dad, and Alex, the son, Malarkey was the name, no lie, came out 5 years after the book was written and said they lied about it. The boy said, I never died and went to heaven. It never happened, but they made a movie about it, a book tour, all of this, and it was a show. It was a sham. 23 Minutes in Hell, there's a preacher that said that he died in his sleep and spent 23 minutes in hell. I remember hearing about this book on some religious station. So I remember going to a library in, where was it? It was in Newington, Connecticut, and I found the book and I brought it home and I thumbed through it, and this guy, it was fanciful tales like Lord of the Rings stuff, but saying this is what happens and God allowed me to spend 23 minutes in hell, so don't go there. It's a farce. It's ridiculous, of course, because everything we know about heaven and hell are recorded in God's Word. There's nothing outside of that that the Bible says. So what is Paul talking about in verse 9? What does God have prepared? Eye hath not seen, ear hasn't heard, it's not even into the heart of man. As important as heaven is, and while it's true we can't comprehend the greatness of heaven, that's not what Paul's talking about in this verse. Paul's not talking about heaven, because in the very next verse, look at it, verse 10, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. So if he's talking about heaven, then I need to go buy some more books from this kid or whoever. I need to know about hell. I'll go talk to Bill Weiss, is this guy's name. I'll go interview him. So what was it like there? No, God has revealed them to us. So if eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, it hasn't even come into the heart of man, well, God has prepared, but God has revealed them unto us, then there's a chance that God is not, through Paul, is not speaking about heaven, what we don't know. I've heard often that heaven, at funerals or when someone's, you know, reminiscing about a loved one, I've heard someone say, you know, in heaven, God has a big front porch. And on the front of the mansion, whatever that might be like, Paul, he's got a front porch cabin. I don't know how a cabin, a mansion, but, you know, you get it. It's heaven, so whatever. There's a front porch, and he's got his fishing pole, and he's sitting in his rocking chair, and I'm like, what is he fishing for? You know, you can't eat the fish, I don't think. I'm not sure, but go with it. And he's fishing there, and he's just whistling Dixie or whatever it might be, and this is what they're doing. And we like to imagine and think in our mind because we just don't know. We know the street of gold. We know that our loved ones are there. We know that Jesus is there. We know that we're healed and we're in heaven. And really, we're going to be singing. I mean, not all the time. We're going to be worshiping. Probably not all the time. We're going to be doing things. But what will we be doing? There's all these questions that Cubbies and Sparkies ask and all of these things, and in Sunday school. But Paul is saying here that what God has prepared for you as a believer, for me, for those who love the Lord, those who are in his family, verse 10, God has revealed that. So the question is, what does God want to do in my life? What is God's plan for me? How can I know this? In essence, he's saying there's never been anyone on this earth who has really, truly, without God's help, tapped into the underbelly of that iceberg. The ice cube is what man knows, and underneath the surface is God's eternal wisdom. No one on this earth has ever been able to really understand, comprehend, or realize God's ultimate plan. In fact, he says in the preceding verses that if the leaders of the world at the time had known that it was the Son of God they were crucifying, they wouldn't have done it. But they didn't know it. They couldn't comprehend the wisdom, the biggie, eternal wisdom of God. And instead, they were led by their eyes, their ears, their emotions. Crucify him. They led the whole crowd. Crucify him. Release this criminal Barabbas. What were they led by? Their eyes, their ears, their emotion. And so many people today are led by that same thing, the little ease in life. We make decisions based on the little ease in life. What does it feel like? What do I hear? What do I see? 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all the things that are in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And those things pass away. The things that we see, we feel, that's what Satan presented to Eve and Adam. Said, if you'll do this, you'll be like God. You'll feel good. You'll have life. You'll be different. And the world promises those things, the ice cubes. Don't settle for ice cubes when God's given you the iceberg. Don't settle for the little ease when God wants you to know the biggie, the eternal wisdom that is only found in God. So what does it have to do with? What has been revealed to us? Verse number 9, what has God prepared for those for us who love him? Well, it has to do with our salvation. It has to do with God's plan for our life right now. Just think about it. Why, you know, wouldn't it be simpler to come to a man and just tell him, a human being, come to a building, go to a man, and tell him all of your faults and all of your sins and all of your thoughts, and then unburden yourself, get rid of them, write them on a piece of paper, burn them, say, here, can I be forgiven of this? That's simple. Wouldn't it be better to pay money so that I can be forgiven of my sin, or I can do X or Y to make sure that these things are done? I could pay money for my loved ones to get out of hell, or I can pay money so that I can get into heaven. I can do enough good so that before I die, I've done so much good. And even there's the credit for my family that they'll do to make sure they know I really wasn't a good guy to get in. It just seems like I've got to be able to do something to guarantee a spot so that God will love me. Well, what does Paul write here? God has revealed them unto us. Those that have been saved, they realize that God's plan makes no sense to people who are holding the ice cubes. They're like, this is ridiculous. God became a man and died in my place, taking my sin on himself, rejected of his Father so that I could be accepted. And now he receives me as I receive him. And I can be in his family. I can be forgiven, a home in heaven, all because of his grace, nothing good that I have done. Well, that's ridiculous. I feel like I should. That's why Paul constantly in the refrain is telling them, not by works of righteousness which we have done. We're holding on to ice cubes and saying, I got to live by my eyes, my ears, my emotions. And Paul is saying, no, God has great things planned for you that eyes and ears and hearts could never even comprehend. That's why the world can't grasp what God has done. And until someone is saved, they don't get it because their eyes are blinded, their ears are deafened, their hearts, as the Bible says, are hardened. You notice how the Bible talks about that? Jesus would constantly say, having eyes, see you not, having ears, hear you not, your hearts are hardened. He says, don't harden your hearts. Well, why is that? Because people think with their eyes, they think with their ears, and they think with their heart. When Christians, we have the biggie, the eternal wisdom of God in front of us. I don't have to be led by my feelings. I don't have to be led by my emotions. In any decision that I make, I should be led by the wisdom that is found in God's Word for me today. God has revealed them to us by His Spirit. So let's look at the verse. It starts with the word but, which is a conjunction. It's a term of contrast. He is contrasting what he has said in verses 6 through 8. He says that we are speaking wisdom among the saved, not the wisdom of the world or the rulers of the world, but the hidden wisdom, verse 7, which none of, verse 8, none of the rulers of the world, the princes, knew this wisdom, or they would not have crucified Jesus. If they knew, if you knew that whatever figure was coming into town today, celebrity, athlete, politician, whoever that might be, you would prepare. But if they came in incognito and you didn't know when they were seated in the auditorium and then they kind of pulled off the hood and here I am, you wouldn't know. Well, here Jesus walked among us, John chapter 1. He robed himself in human flesh. He hid his glory from mankind. And yet we see now through the Holy Spirit and through the revealed Word of God that He has revealed Himself to us. We are saved not because we're white, we're Southern, we're American, we're rich, we're poor, we're educated, uneducated, whatever the case may be. We're saved by the grace and the mercy of God. Nothing good that we have done, but according to His mercy. So the first word, but as it is written, so it's said before. We won't take time to go there, but this verse is from Isaiah 64, verse 4. He says, as it is written, meaning it's been said before. What does Isaiah 64, 4 say? This is what it says from God. For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by ear, neither hath the eye seen, O God, beside thee, what he hath prepared for them that waiteth for him. Paul says, but as it is written, this has been said before. I'm just repeating what God's already said. God has something prepared for those who love Him and wait for Him. Meaning, you're part of the family, just God has something for you. You know, this is why the prosperity gospel is so dangerous. Because the prosperity gospel trades in the true gospel, the deep wisdom of God, the bottom of the iceberg for ice cubes, saying, if you do this via Ponzi scheme, you build this up and God is going to do this for you. So you make sure that you can never be good enough. You can never give enough. You can never do enough. But if you do, God will. Of course, there's the law in the Bible of sowing and reaping. We reap what we sow. We sow good things, we reap good things. But many prosperity preachers have taken it basically on steroids. And it has scared so many Christians away from even, as we talked earlier, giving their tithe or giving their missions or even just giving their life to God. Don't let the prosperity preachers fool you. Don't go down that path and believe the lie. Here, he's saying it's been written, God has something prepared for you, but it's not something that the world views as tangible. Money, credit, things of that nature, brick and mortar. Jesus constantly said, don't lay up treasure for yourself here, but in heaven. Many would have you believe, based on what I wear, my watch, my duds, my shoes, my car, my home, whatever, I am blessed of God, truly blessed, let me tell you. Let me show you how I'm blessed, because I do this, God loves me, you want Him to love you too, this is what you do, let's do it together, come on now. Bunk. What does the Bible say? God has prepared something for those that love Him, and it's not something that you can put a price tag on. It's not something that we can tangibly just hold in our hands, although we are blessed by God to see the building almost paid off, things being done in our lives and in our homes. Salvation has no price tag. What will a man gain? I mean, what really worth is it if he gets the entire world and he loses his own soul? Neat story last night, Ukraine, the deputy prime minister, or maybe it's the vice president, cried out, actually tweeted at Elon Musk and said, we need help. We have no internet. Within 24 hours, the richest man in the world said, it's up and running. Let's do this. I won't say the most brilliant man on the planet, but definitely the wealthiest man on the planet. And yet, for all that he has in his talent, if he doesn't know the Lord. And yet, here we are, you know, with the eye, the ear, the heart, we're making decisions on our future or on our present based on how we feel. Well, there's something greater than what we feel, and that is that God sent His Son to die on the cross for us, to give us new life. He gave us something that we could never purchase through our good works or through giving to a church or being just, I don't know, born into the right family. So Paul is saying, as it is written, he's already stated that the unsaved don't believe something, but they put their faith and trust in something. Their faith, the unbelievers, is contrasted by true faith. They must see to believe. Unbelievers must feel their way into believing. They must experience it before they will trust it. And that's how the world is. Eric Weinmeier, who was a blind mountain climber, I love his story. He's someone that I believe at the age of 12 totally lost his vision. But if you read his story, he just talks about what led him to go as an adventurer, as a mountain climber. He's climbed Everest several times, the first blind climber to climb Everest. He's climbed every peak in the world, sometimes twice, sometimes three times. This guy is, Whit, I saw you with your not canoes on the front, whatever that is. What's on the kayaks? The dude kayaks. I mean, he's blind, for goodness sake. He's scaling up the side of all of these things. But when you look at his life and you see what he's doing, he says, I don't let what I can't see stop me from living my life and enjoying what's going on around me. But the lost, the Bible says, they are blinded. They feel their way into believing. They have to see it to believe it. The lost are searching for the meaning of life and the purpose, but they search for God through means that exclude the wisdom of God. Their search is based on empirical or experimental knowledge, rationalism, as we learned last week, which is, again, taught in schools, universities, and many homes. I've got to see it, hear it, feel it. See it, hear it, feel it. And if I don't see it, hear it, feel it, then it can't be true. And really, the basis of faith is not based on seeing, hearing, or feeling. Human wisdom turns against divine truth, and ultimately it led people to crucify Jesus. That's verse number 8. So the biggie, eternal wisdom can't be known by eye, ear, or emotion. Human wisdom is the iceberg. It's visible. I can see it, feel it, touch it, experience it, observation. But the wisdom of God is invisible. It's deep. And it's something that touches our soul. Ephesians chapter 4 says this, we should not walk as the Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind, having their understanding darkened, alienated from the life of God through ignorance because of the blindness of their heart. They can't see. They can't feel. All they do is, how can I experience this? What does this mean? And we may have lost folks here today. And you remember at one point in your life when you didn't know the Lord and you went to church and, well, I don't like that, or I do like this, or even as saved people, well, I don't like that, or I do like this, but everything based on God's word and not on our feelings, that's what is going to last. So Paul's saying the wisdom of God is so important. They are searching, they are essentially driving blind through life, and they go after these things. So ultimately, Paul says God's design and plan is something that no man could imagine or think of. Why did God send his son to die? Why was that the plan? That was the plan before the foundation of the world. He knew that Christ would come. Christ knew, and he agreed, I will go, and I will be the sacrifice. Adam and Eve sinned. The coats of skin covered them. All the sacrifices throughout the Old Testament, even to the point where it was the sacrifices were pointing to the supreme sacrifice, the blood of one man, Hebrews says. His blood was offered one time, or his sacrifice. He put himself in our place, Romans chapter 5, verse 10. Wherefore, as by one man's sin, Adam, that came into the world, his disobedience, his sin, but by one man's submission to what God called him to do, the Son of God, to the cross, we can all be saved. The world tells us that we should indulge our desires to find happiness. God tells us to control our desires to find joy. The world says to fight, get judgment, get revenge, because if you don't, you'll be a wimp. The Bible says, or God's wisdom tells us to love our enemies, extend forgiveness, because then we'll be called a child of God. The world says we should do whatever we can and get away with it. After all, everyone's doing it. Just look at San Francisco. I saw a video this morning early of guys going in there and just clearing out the medical stuff, filling backpacks, and people filming it, watching it, doing nothing about it. The world says just do all you can all you get, but God's wisdom says we'll all face judgment for every idle thought, every hidden thing. You won't get away with anything because you'll stand before God. The world says medals, trophies, possessions, and position, that's what's most important. That's what you need. But God's wisdom says character and commitment are the most important thing. What you do with the Lord, not what you have tucked away in a garage, a 401k, what is parked there, what you're living in, what you're wearing, all of those things are wonderful and great, but they won't get you any closer to heaven. They actually might get you closer to hell, because people see, hear, and feel those things more than what Christ has done for them upon the cross. Let's bring it in for a landing. So the Bible says this: we walk by faith and not by sight, eyes, ears, heart. Galatians 3:11, the just shall live by faith. Hebrews 11, you know this verse. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Have you ever seen heaven? Were you there, as the song says, when they crucified my Lord? No, but through the eye of faith, I can see that God has a plan for me. I can see that what he said in his word is true, not just because I feel, because there are days when I feel like I don't even feel saved. I feel lousy. I feel discouraged. 2 weeks ago, I preached on that from 1 Samuel. I feel like I'm in the cave. I feel like it's dark. But my feelings about my faith do not dictate how God feels about his children. God loves us. We are adopted in, and you are born into the family of God. Can you be unborn because you don't feel very saved? No. That's not theology. That is feeling, eyes, ears, heart into believing. Where Christ says, even though you don't see, you believe. That is faith. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, so that the things that are seen were made of things which do appear. God spoke. Poof. There it is. God spoke it. God formed man from the dust of the earth. That takes faith. Last part of the verse, eye hath not seen, ear, nor ear heard, neither entered into the heart of man heart. Brian and I were talking this week, and it's so interesting, about the air traffic control. The heart is the control center, the seat of emotions. And he was telling me some stuff that really was kind of mind-blowing, and I'm like, I don't know if I want to get on a plane again, but I understand. Harvey flies planes, and his wife flies planes, and think Wayne. He also flies. There's a lot of people in here that fly planes, but his son-in-law is an air traffic controller and just above a certain level in the sky. And the stress level for those guys to make sure that they're, okay, don't do this and don't do that. Okay, you come in here and the heart, Proverbs 4:23, Jesus talks about the heart is the air traffic control center. What goes in and what comes out is so important. Keep or guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. For believers, that is so important, because how I feel about something might not be exactly what's really happening in reality. It might be how I feel about it, but I need to guard my heart, which means I guard my purity, I guard my marriage, I guard my family, I guard my finances, I guard everything in life, because little blips on the radio are popping up, and boy, we could kind of lose it because there's so much going on. But we have the Lord that gives us the peace that passes all understanding. No matter what we face, God helps us to make it through, but you got to guard your heart. So the question is, have you had a heart checkup lately with the Lord? Have you had a heart checkup? Maybe you've gone to your doctor, but have you had a heart checkup where you have said, Lord, do a work in me. Lord, do something in me. So he says, it's written, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. It does not describe unbelievers. It doesn't describe people saying, oh, God's got a great plan for my life because... No, if you're a child of God, you can know it, because the very next verse says, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. While many misapply or misinterpret this verse, and it's written everywhere and anywhere as it relates to heaven, it's talking about right here, right now. We don't have to go through this life with a frown on our face. Turn that frown upside down, right? We don't have to go through life like that. And we don't have to fool ourselves into thinking that, let's just fake it. Let's just get through. As parents, you have to fake it sometimes, don't you? You know what I'm talking about? I remember when the kids were very little, and we had the what kind of rocker was that, Claire and the baby? A glider. The best thing ever. And you have the little glider thing. You put your stool. I just know what a recliner is. If you give other names to pieces of furniture, I know couch, table, chairs, and recliner, glider. But you're sitting there at 3 in the morning with a baby that's colicky so that your spouse can sleep and we're taking turns. I don't feel like being a parent right now. I feel like being in bed. I don't like this. I don't like this smell. I don't like this sound. And I've got to go to work in 2 hours. Could you please hurry up and go to sleep? Whatever it is, I don't feel very parenty. But yet what we see here is that God has a plan for our lives that sometimes we couldn't write the script if we tried. We couldn't even think it up. God has great things planned, and it starts with salvation, that he has brought you into the family. You have received Christ as your Savior if you know him. And if you know him, even on the hard days where you have to muster up a smile and you have to get on your knees and say, God, I don't even feel like I can pray, there is victory, because he said, you're going to make it through. He's your child. He's not going to leave you out there to die. He's not going to leave you out there to doubt. He's not going to leave you out there in the cave to be discouraged. He's got a plan for your life. God has wonderful things planned for us. We can trust God's word. We can trust the Bible. What he said is true. And if you don't know the Lord, I'll end the way we started. I started with a question. What does God want to do with my life? What does God have prepared for me? A future and a present. Nothing can ever prepare you for life after graduation, marriage, parenting, career. Let me give you the most important question here, though. Are you prepared for death? You know, graduation is one thing. Marriage is another thing. Parenting is quite another thing. Career, something else. But what about death? Once you're gone, there's no return. Are you prepared to meet God in the condition you're in? And that goes both ways, for Christians and unbelievers. If you don't know the Lord, the Bible says that you can know the Lord. You can receive Christ based on what he has done for you, and you can put your faith in him and what he has done on the cross for you. You can trust him. Admit that you're a sinner. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Call upon him, and you can do it right here, right now, today, anytime. He'll listen to you. Don't come to a church. Don't tell me your sins. Don't do that for anyone. You can go directly to Jesus. And the Bible says when you come to him, he won't say, get out. I don't need you. I don't want you. You're too dirty for me. Christians, heart checkup. Have you done that lately? Are you prepared for death? Are you living like you died yesterday and you just haven't notified your face yet, right? You're just walking through life. Oh, man, I just can't. Man, God has given us life and we can live it more abundantly. There's something we have to shout about. And I'm so thankful that we have God's word. I can stand on his promises and I don't have to worry, even though I don't know about tomorrow. I don't have to worry. Friends of mine are saying, you need to get a copy of Red Dawn. Some of you say, what is that? It's some movie that was made. I believe it's a book. Russia's going to invade, or this is going to happen, or this is happening in the economy. And there's a lot of bad stuff going on in our world and even in our country. But in the midst of failing economy, dithering leadership, world war on the stage, all the above, gas prices rising, shelf stocks falling, God is in control. And this world is not my home. It's not cliche. It's true if you're a believer. And we might be in heaven before we say the final prayer. So let's look at the verse as it is written. Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither entered into the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. I'm not going to live my life by the little E's and hold on to ice cubes when I can live by the eternal truth of God's word, the wisdom that's only found in Scripture. And God wants to bless my life, not because I deserve it, but because I'm his child and he loves me. And because I want to obey what he says in his word. So I ask, would you do the same? Would you trust the Lord? Have faith in him even when you can't see, you don't feel it, and it's hard to understand. That's faith. You have to trust God even when it's hard. We can do that together. Let's pray. Now is the time to